And obviously from the work that has been brought forward, as John rightfully said, bus franchising has emerged as the strongest of all the available options at Tiwas and is thus recommended as the preferred model to take forward. John's also right to say this is not the end of the process. This is a really important gateway decision, but obviously it leads to greater and further detailed financial assessment. Also crucially, that statutory audit. But for me, the most important element will be that statutory consultation that we're obliged to do. The whole point of a public transport network is it's there to deliver for our public. So it's absolutely right that the public should have the opportunity to comment and give us their thoughts and ideas through a very detailed consultation exercise that we'll be obliged to do. And then once all that kind of work has been done, that will obviously allow that to report back to yourself and the combined authority to take a final decision later in 2022. As said before, I alluded to the fact how long I've been reading these type of documents. I've been working in this industry for good or ill now for almost two decades. I can honestly say, with my hand on my heart, that this is the most important and probably best project I've ever had the privilege of being involved in. And I cannot strongly commend this report enough to the combined authority and warmly endorse all the recommendations that are contained within it. Thank you.
Thanks, Lou. Do we have any questions? Councillor Mulder.
Thank you much, Mayor, and thank John and Lou for their excellent presentations there. As John and Lou both quite rightly said, there's a long way to go in this process and there's a lot of issues to discuss and agree. But maybe my question about the Metro Mayor is on the cost of transition. And franchising has a higher cost of transition than partnership. How will we be able to fund this?
If you want to take that, John.
Thank you. Yeah, the report sets out further work is to be done on affordability of service, including those transition costs. We'll do this before embarking on the independent audit phase, and we'll keep members informed of that. Current funding position does create some uncertainty, particularly if our BSIP, the government funding that we'll receive for the next stage of bus service improvement, is lower than perhaps we've expected. And there's uncertainty continues over what else might come to this Liverpool City Region for transport services. We do have a number of potential options to raise revenue to support any potential transition, and these will be looked at as part of this process. It's proposed that some of the larger capital costs would be funded by borrowing. Oh, sorry, it's anticipated at this stage that some of the larger capital costs would be funded by borrowing, which would largely be repaid from future bus revenues. But that, again, is subject to future decision making.
And if I could just add, Councillor Morgan, there's a letter on my desk if we are to progress this issue today positively and go forward that asks some of those questions of government, because we were asked to be ambitious in our ESIP proposals, and we have been £667 million to be spot on. So that shows the ambition. And to get to those London style transport systems across the country, the government's going to have to provide London style subsidies so that we can do that. It's only CRSTS is only part of the overall package, but I think it's a pertinent question, because that will be based on decisions that haven't yet been taken. Anybody else for any questions? Councillor Williamson.
Firstly, thank you to John and me, and I agree with you about London Transport. It's a great level up, and it should be here to, our residents deserve to see. So I'd just like to ask how the franchising model could support economic growth in the city region.
Matt's going to answer that one about me.
Yeah, thanks. I think our expectation really would be that franchising kind of provides a platform for economic growth, and really about the insurance of the network being designed on not just commercial principles, but to make sure that it supports communities, supports businesses, both socially and economically. And I'd suggest actually that would be those things would be key indicators of whether franchising is successful or not, should it happen. I think bus debate, which was a big bit of engagement we did with customers. What that showed is that overall we've got quite a good bus network, but there are times of day in certain places where it doesn't meet the needs of the region, and coverage can be kind of quite limited. So the BSIP that was mentioned kind of acknowledges that, identifies some of the links that maybe aren't there, and some of those are centred around some of the key employment sites that we've got in the region. What I would say is that theoretically under each model with funding, some of those issues could be addressed, but our expectation would be that franchising would allow that overall network design principle to take place, for that to address those types of issues, and I guess make sure that customers, employees, the public, businesses are all better linked by the transport system.
Anybody else for any other questions? Councillor Walton?
Thank you, Council Mayor. First of all, I'd like to echo my thanks as well to John and Liam for outstanding work that we've done on this piece of very, very important decision for us. But I do recognise how important it is, but how does it affect the good relationships we have with our bus operators, and does that possibly have a negative impact on our passengers?
Okay, I think that's probably Matt, isn't it? Yes.
Yeah, I can certainly pick that up, but I think John alluded to this in the presentation of the report. I think in many ways this moves us to a new phase in terms of our relationships with the operators. Franchising probably isn't the direction that certainly our two major operators would want to see happen in the region. And I think there's also been alluded to, we've worked really effectively over the last 5 or 6 years with the bus operators through the Bus Alliance. I would say that we've got one of the strongest and most effective partnerships between a transport authority, a combined authority and bus operators anywhere in the UK, and particularly in the last couple of years through COVID. I think with that, one of the things we've always recognised is our common ground, which is the customer, the passenger. So although we come from different perspectives, that's always the common ground. So I've determined that in this next phase we continue to work together effectively with the operators, kind of in the here and now, to make sure that we're improving the offer for the customer, for the passenger, that we maintain as far as we can those good relationships we've had. I think the recommendations actually support that approach, that we continue that kind of constructive, collaborative approach with operators, and I guess now more than ever as we kind of recover from COVID, that's important, we maintain that.
Thanks, Matt. Anybody else? Councillor Baines?
Thanks very much, and I just want to thank Liam and officers and yourself as well, Steve, for leading on this, and for the manifesto pledge of yours, and it's something I fully support. It's been 36 years of consumer success since the mistake, but that's just all, you know, the regulated bus and services here and across the country outside the union. Now we've got the power, it's right, but we need to put the communities first again. So as I say, it's the right thing to do for many reasons. What's not been touched on yet, I wonder if Liam could maybe tell us a little bit about the way that franchising would help us reach our net zero ambitions and complete the region's act.
Yeah, absolutely, more than happy to say. I think from our perspective, this has to be a key part of how we shift away from the private car as being the way for transport, to actually get more people onto the public transport network. And the great opportunity with what's been recommended here is it would give the combined authority and all six districts all the policy levers in one place to actually prioritise a really good high quality public transport network. So the ability to set routes and network coverage that covers kind of all of our communities allows people to go from A to B in the most seamless fashion. Crucially as well, putting in place the best value ticketing fares, so actually kind of there's that natural incentive to use the bus as opposed to jump into the car. And making it much more comprehensive, you are alluded to the fact that it doesn't always feel like a collective network. One of London's strengths is that it is a collective network, so how we can make sure it's a more uniform approach. But I think probably the most important element, particularly with regard to air quality, from where the bus network sits, is that vision about a completely zero emissions bus system, which is at the heart of our vision. And obviously, for 2030,
joined by members of the public and the public gallery, and many of those are very interested in what we do here today. Can I first of all thank you all for the way in which you've conducted your lobbying of myself and others, and I think it's been a really fruitful exercise, and you've heard the depth of feeling today. The question that I get asked most is how come it's taking you so long. In fact, I was attacked by an opposition councillor from Liverpool, the leader of one of the minority parties there, who said we should just get on and do it. And it shows you the danger of people like that not understanding the complexity of this issue that's now taken 5 years to get to where we are today. Because the one thing that we'll never do is jeopardise the combined authority and hopefully not have to go through any judicial review. So that's why it's been painstakingly long. But we are in a position now, hopefully, where we will get to the right decision. And in regard to that decision, can I propose that we take the recommendations on block today? And because of the members who are here, who are interested in this issue in the chamber, can we do that by a show of hands so that you can see that we're supportive? So is that okay? Yeah, can we do that? So if I move towards the recommendation on page 19, can we show whether we're supportive of that or not? Just hold your hands up. Well, oh, I'll go for that.
I sort of am. It's just what people take the photos for us. So, fantastic.
Genuinely momentous, I think. Brilliant. What a great decision. Okay, we'll move on. But if the members of the public do want to leave, I know you've got other things on. If you want to stay, you're very welcome to stay. But if you do want to go, thanks for your attendance. Okay, while some people move the way out of the chamber, we move on to item 6. Which is a report that provides an overview of the revenue and capital financial performance of the Combined Authority for the period April 2021 to January 2022. John Fogarty again will take us through this report. John.
Thank you. This paper is the regular budget monitoring paper. It presents the financial update for the period ending on December 31st. It's quarterly. The report proposes a number of adjustments to the budget to accommodate some planned slippage of various programmes into next year. These are principally around rolling stock, tidal energy and digital projects which are continuing to recover ground that was lost due to the pandemic. It also includes significantly £1 million from current year's budget that when we get to next year's budget as a result of the work that we've just discussed around bus reform. The report also presents a capital programme update, including passive and TTF schemes, and I'm happy to answer any questions that may have on the paper.
Any questions for John? If not, can we agree the recommendations on page 539? Please. I stumbled a little bit there because it seems to be a huge jump, didn't it, from page 19 to 539, but that's because of the bus strategy. Okay, 7 then is a report that sets out the proposed allocation of £53.3 million for adult education across the city region to grant funders and contracts for services following a procurement exercise, and it is also asking for the approval to accept £4.4 million in National Skills Fund Level 3 adult offer. So adult education, as we all know, is key to our depot settlement. It's one of the main blocks that we've got, and a real example of how we then have responded to that devolution and to the adult education needs of our residents, supporting their learning and innovation in regard to the way we deliver that locally. So Mayor Anson, you're going to take us through this report.
Thanks, Thatcher. The devolution of the adult education budget has hugely beneficial to the Liverpool City Region, supporting over 32,000 learners each year and delivering more provision in the skills, priorities, areas that we need. We've introduced local flexibilities that benefit our residents, including fully funded provision for more low-income learners, establishing new learning lanes and testing new ways of delivering. Entering year four of the Liverpool is an exciting phase for us in the new commissioning cycle, the detail of which is outlined in the report. The report seeks approval to accept the annual grant allocation for the adult education budget of £53.3 million and the delegated level 3 adult offer of £4.4 million for the academic year 22-23. It also sets out the proposed grant funded allocation to a number of organisations, including colleges and local authorities, based on prior year allocations. Following the end of the current 3-year commission cycle, a new procurement round has been completed and the recommendations of the allocation to the contracts for service provision to the ranked orders of providers is included at Appendix 1. Approval is sought to enable the conclusion of the procurement exercise by the Compound Authority Treasurer and Monitoring Officer. An additional scheme of delegation in Section 6 is also requested to conclude the allocation of Level 3 provision and award contracts accordingly. Resources are requested to continue to operate a facilitation fund of circa £2.6 million to respond to in-year demand as described in Section 4. Combined Authority are also asked to note the summary of the data provided in Appendix 2 relating to the academic year 20-21 A, B, D, and E. Appendix 1, which is not for publication, outlines the outcome of the procurement exercise. A number of providers are recommended for contract awards based on the £14 million available budget. This will result in a change in the provider base, however, all risk will be outlined in the course and will be managed accordingly and subject to due diligence.
Thanks, Mayor Anderson. Anybody want to add anything further? That was just, we were talking about adult education with the Secretary of State on Wednesday, and they've started to recognise some of the innovation that we're doing in the Liverpool City Region. So it's not just getting a block of money and doing what government would have done for us, we're doing things differently and getting better results, we're getting a bigger bang for our buck. So the government could take some lessons from what we're doing, and they were really interested in some of that innovation to roll it out further. If there's no other questions, can we agree the recommendations on page 561? Item 8 is the social value framework, which has been developed to articulate Combined Authority's social value policy and provide a framework to guide its implementation. And it identifies how all parts of the Combined Authority can contribute to maximising social value. And people remember that I gave a manifesto commitment to produce an annual report on social value, and this framework provides a mechanism for us to achieve that. Framework itself will take effect from the 1st of April, and the first annual report will come out to the Combined Authority obviously next year. It builds on the existing good practice rolled out during my first term of office, where social value was a feature of the Combined Authority's investment and purchasing decisions and was measured in the services commissioned. This new policy and framework commits the Combined Authority at all levels of the organisation to do more and to do better in the future, and also to be held accountable for the social value that we generate in our communities, which I think dovetails well. I know Liverpool City Council have recently done a social value policy. I think others have either got them or are on the way to looking at them. I think it all pulls it together so that we can maximise the extent of the investments that we're all making across the 6 districts. Are there any questions for the Mayor? Councillor Williamson's going to take us through the report itself.
Thank you. I think I know excited about this as well, Councillor Robertson was about the bus reform earlier. and yeah, this brings together where, you know, my colleagues are already doing on their individual councils, and certainly something that I think I'd like to say we're all working away on in terms of community wealth building and social value. Across the portfolio, held a for inclusive economy in the third sector. I'd like to echo the Metro Mayor's comments and state my support for the social value policy and framework. We are committed to tackling the unacceptable challenges of our economy, environmental degradation and inequalities that continue to affect the health, well-being and quality of life of our communities. This new framework will help the combined authority to address these challenges by embedding a focus on social value in everything that it does. Going well beyond the minimum requirements of the 2012 Social Value Act, our approach ensures that social value benefits are realised in all activity across the organisation and not just procurement. The framework builds on and expands the existing good practice in social value, sets out commitments which relate to the combined authority's various roles as an employer, an organisation with devolved powers for investment, commissioning and service delivery as a civic leader. This broad focus includes benefits that are wide-ranging, such as commitment to participate in the Safe Spaces initiative to make travel centres available safe spaces for anyone who feels unsafe, a commitment to embed social value commitments into funding agreements that form the combined authority investments, commitments to embed a focus on social value within the combined authority's leadership development programme and implement a reverse mentoring programme. Alongside this, the social value framework outlines how the combined authority will fully embed social value into its procurement and commissioning processes. We will be held to account on these commitments, and will publish an annual review of social value impact to evidence what social value is being created, what is working well, and where we can improve and further develop this approach. I look forward to working in collaboration with stakeholders from across the city region to support the implementation of the combined authorities' social value policy and framework. This will help us to fully realise our shared vision of a fairer, stronger, more inclusive and cleaner Liverpool City region. And I'm really, really proud of this matter. Thank you.
Yeah, I think on behalf of yourself, Lynn Collins has got to leave us, and she's been pivotal in this, as Kate Downs as well, but also yourself driving this agenda.